call the March 13th school committee meeting to order, and the first order of business is a public hearing on our FY18 school budget. Patty, you want to do a brief summary of the budget, or Len, one of you, and we'll entertain any questions from our audience.
So all I want to say is that I'm excited for the opportunities that Whately Elementary School is having with their full day preschool, and I'm very proud of the fact that we were able to do this without hiring any more teachers or any more staff. We are really excited about this service that we're providing to the young children in our community. And I know that we've been very thoughtful about putting this budget together. Principal Christofoli and I have had conversations, and so I'm going to let Patty do the details, but I would like to just commend everyone, and especially the school committee and the administration, for allowing us to add on this half day preschool. It will make a difference. Thank you.
So do you want me to go through all of it, or just sort of give an abbreviation of the abbreviation?
I'd say an abbreviation of the abbreviation, and then if we have any questions, we can entertain those questions.
So this is the budget that we presented the other night to the Whately Select Board and FinCom, and we are requesting an increase of 2.93%, or $46,802. The primary drivers of the increase are all around our collective bargaining agreements. So we have people moving on step, that's adding about $15,784. The agreement for the increase, the negotiated increase, was 2.5%, which was $19,220. A new degree was added to the collective bargaining agreement, and we had, I believe, three staff members move, and that cost us $2,113. The lead teacher stipend increased by $1,100. We have to increase the non-union salary increases by $1,160, and we'll be bringing those to you, the recommendations for the non-union, in May for you to approve in June. And then we move some school lunch salaries. Because we wanted to bring some stability to the lunch program, we wanted to move the salaries of the two people working there so that we can make sure that our school lunch fund does not end in a negative balance, because that affects the town's excess and deficiency. And we did decrease an instructional assistant for next year, which will save us $23,789. That did take effect this year, but we did deduct it again from, it'll be a decrease to next year's budget. The central office percentage decreased slightly from 9.11% to 9.21%, and we did talk about those salaries that drove the cost up because we lost some grant funding. School committee expenses are increasing because we were paying our dues to the collaborative out of a grant, which we weren't supposed to be doing, so we have to bring it onto the budget. And then we have some minor expenses that we need to adjust so that they become in line with our spending patterns. The transportation, slight $476. We are in a five-year contract with Gribco, and this is just the adjustment for the COLA. And then decreases to our budget. We did not have anyone retire, so we could reduce our retirement buyback expense. And also we have a sixth grader moving on to seventh, so that tuition of $27,000 will go away. And that nets us down to the $46,802, or 2.93%. We did get an email. I don't know if you want to talk about this now. Okay. We got an email after our meeting with the town of Whately from the town administrator, Brian Domina, who asked us to relook at our utilities. And it was something that I had a note to do and then never went back to. So I did look at it this morning, and I think that we could adjust it. We did make, the town of Whately, with their CPC grants, made a lot of investments in the building, which are supposed to be energy saving. I like to get through one full year of cycle to see what the adjustments will be before we reduce it. But our three-year spending pattern has been less than what we're budgeting. And also the other thing that was, I was hesitant, I look at, even though it's electricity and gas heating separate, I sort of use them both together to make sure if one's over and the other's under, we're gonna be good. We couldn't, if you remember correctly, I couldn't get a permanent gas price because we had unassigned capacity, so we had to go a year at market price to get the assigned capacity so that we can get the lower rates. So after reviewing all that, I did speak with Brian, and I think we can comfortably reduce our budget by an additional $6,000 this year, and then relook at them again next year, because we'll have a year's worth of the energy management savings, and also we'll be able to lock in a gas price. So I would recommend to the committee to consider reducing the budget by $6,000. That would mean that we would be requesting an increase of $40,802, or 2.55%. And I have copies of the budget at that level, so for you to discuss, and then so that you'll have that to look at when you go to vote the budget later this evening on the agenda.
Very good. Anybody on the committee have any further questions? I know we've been hammering this for the past couple of months, so I don't have any other questions.
The only thing I noticed, Patty, is on page two, you said net decrease, but I think it's actually increase.
Okay.
Yeah.
Increase, just to correct the version with the salary.
Right.
Does anybody have any questions in the audience? Mr. Antea.
Yeah, I've got a couple of questions. Dr. Carey, in your overview in front of the budget, just so that we have, I get a sense of it, okay? We're always looking towards value. We know what we spend. We have an idea of what we get back. But that doesn't really paint the true picture of the value in itself. And in your statement here, Frontier Regional and Union 38 schools, we are proud of our teachers' efforts for Frontier and Union 38 schools at the forefront in instructional strategies. So what we're paying for is our instructional strategies that are at the forefront of education at this time.
Research-based best practices.
So what does that mean? If someone were to come here and ask, what does that mean? Like I'm doing now. What does that mean?
Well, our teachers have taken, they have been trained in differentiation, approaching children through different modalities, providing authentic, meaningful tasks in learning. Years ago, the traditional way was they would hand out worksheets, and then they would do round-robin reading with the students, and it was all very rote, and it wasn't very deep. What they do today is they actually provide students with challenging and deep thinking when they do activities. They go from center to center, and then the teacher works with a group. The way we present reading instruction now through guided reading is a lot more in-depth. It causes the children to be more critical when they think. It's hard work to think that deep, but once you open up those thinking connections in your brain, you begin to look at everything with a very quizzical and curious mind, and you'll be able to become a problem solver. What we know today is that we are a society of information. You can get information anywhere. The kids don't need to memorize things anymore. What they need to do is be able to find the information and then manipulate it, to use that information to create something different, or something, solve a problem that takes deeper thought.
So would you say Whately Elementary School is a little bit ahead of the curve in that regard, or are we at the curve, or are we trying to get onto the curve?
I would say Whately, especially the teachers, they really look at the way children learn. because it's a small school, they're able to know each child almost individually, and everyone working with that child knows the way that child learns. My most experience is in, I want to say, fourth grade. Is that the one, or is it fifth? What's Lacey's class?
Fifth
grade. The most experience I have is in fifth grade, and that's a large class, but there's also very divergent learners in there. And the kinds of activities that you have the different students do actually speak to them. You can know the students on a personal level, and what we're calling that, what Massachusetts is calling it, is called personalized learning. It's not one size fits all. That's really what we need to be thinking about. We cannot teach the way we used to teach because kids are coming to us differently now. We all know that. There's no sense going into it, but they're wired differently. It's all the video, it's all this. But they also need to become active learners. They need to become active in their own learning and take responsibility for what they're learning. So what we're trying to do is develop that innate motivation. And it sounds pretty abstract, but when you see it in practice, when you really watch the way these students are exposing, the teachers are setting up these environments where the children are exposed to learning, and they are able to choose and how they're going to learn it or how they're going to approach it. It's like giving an assignment and then saying you can do it one of three ways, and the child chooses the way they want to learn it and to show mastery, and that makes them more invested in it.
Sounds great. So that's what parents should expect their children to be, the development of their children over time in this school.
Ever since accountability came into play, and we have these standardized tests, the reason these standardized tests are so hard, or they're difficult, is because they're asking for depth of knowledge, depth of understanding and learning and manipulating information. So you can't study, just like you can't really study for an SAT or a GRE, you can't really study for an MCAS, because it is what you know and how to use it, but a lot of times you'll see in those questions, they give you the information, but they want you to compare and contrast, they want you to find the threads and the patterns, or the differences, and to be able to speak to those. So they're giving you the information, they want to know how you're manipulating it. And this will go on through high school, through college, through anything. And we are starting earlier. Students are learning to read in kindergarten. I mean, that's an expectation now. It wasn't when I started in education. When my kids were in kindergarten, it wasn't. So these are the things that Whately students, in particular, but all students, are expected. We're expecting critical thinkers. We're expecting the kids to learn in a deeper way, to be able to manipulate information, because the information's there for everyone.
Thank you. Can I follow that up? In the cost, salary-related costs, we have a net decrease of $45,000.
That's actually the mistake that I was pointing out.
The word should be increase instead of decrease.
I was going to say that. I look at this and I look at that. It
sets you in the wrong direction.
I just corrected it and I'll be printing new ones.
Okay. But beyond that, I know it's a small amount, okay? But when we're thinking about costs and we're thinking about the best atmosphere for any given classroom at any given time, what is the rationale for supporting teachers to go beyond the master's level? And what does that mean? And if they do, which it looks like some have, and more will, how does that translate to the benefit of the taxpayers' children in that school, in that particular classroom?
In the same way we want our children to become lifelong learners, to have that innate motivation to continue to learn at every chance they get, we also would like to encourage our staff the same way, because every time they advance in their educational program, they learn new things. They become better teachers. They are growing in their craft. If we were doctors, of course, we'd be reading all of those, those journals that they get about the new practices. They'd be going to conferences. Teachers take classes where they're learning the newest and the most research-based practices that will enhance their teaching. So we're hoping, and we believe it does. I mean, research will tell you, and clearly our evidence tells us that the more training our teachers have, the better they are in the classroom. The better their instruction is, the more confidence they have, and the students will benefit from that. Particularly, veteran teachers. Mm-hmm. They need to keep learning as well as everyone, and they do here because we encourage it and we reward it.
And from a human resource perspective, not just the educational, we want the best teachers in our school, and we want to keep them motivated to be the best. And because the expectations for them are so high, because they have to recertify, so most of them are taking classes so they can recertify their license. So you do want to keep them motivated and happy, because we want to have the best of the best here. So from a human resource perspective, it's to keep our employees, happy as well.
So will the next step in negotiations be PhD? We'll end up with PhDs in elementary schools?
I don't know if that's the future.
That is the next step. I mean, when you look at this, masters plus 45, I mean, you're not far away. And at some point, some negotiator is going to put that on the table, and then we're going to end up paying for people to actually obtain degrees that they won't use for the benefit of our kids.
Well, at the high school level, we have some clock. Doctorates at Frontier.
Well, that's high school. I can see, I can see physics and in some of those top end science and math, but in the basic elementary programs,
Well, a doctorate, and I can speak from experience, my doctorate took me 4 years, and that was nonstop. Every 4 months I was doing another course. I was constantly, and my dissertation was quite extensive, and I had to be vetted, and I had to do a lot of things. I can't see a lot of people doing that unless they're truly, truly motivated. It's a long, arduous journey. A CAGS is great. A CAGS can prepare you to move up. The teachers today, we're hoping, especially our young ones, will become the leaders in the next few years. As this generation moves out, we need to be making sure our younger generation, especially people who are dedicated to Union 38, Frontier, Whately, we want to see those people become the leaders. And you do need, unfortunately, a CAGS, which is a Certificate of Advanced Graduate Studies, to be a leader. Mr. Christofoli has a CAGS.
I could add a couple of things, if that's okay.
Oh, yeah.
So your point is well taken. I mean, I understand strictly from the economic side that two parties come together and they have to negotiate. And I'm sure that all across the state, schools like ours, districts like ours, are adding columns, because that's part of the negotiation piece. Setting that aside, and again, I think the everyday thinking is very much in line with what you said, Paul, that, I can see maybe somebody teaching physics or chemistry or something like that. Well, I would propose, and that is certainly true, but I would also propose to you that kids in kindergarten, first, second grade, who are struggling, kids who we're trying to bring to baseline. If you think of your average students in the middle on a bell curve, then you need very talented people to get those most talented kids to understand things like advanced physics, AP chemistry. You also need very talented teachers to take those kids who are struggling early in life and bring them to a place where they can be effective learners. And I think that that's part of what goes into, when teachers go out and get more, whether they're in school and adding credits, Paul, or whether they're just going to conferences or taking workshops and really learning how to hone their craft, I would argue that it's equally important and equally intense and difficult to sometimes meet the needs of struggling learners too. We think about it as, oh, it's elementary, you know, and quite frankly, if you look at it strictly from a contractual perspective, one might say, well, sure, elementary must be easier because they get paid less than high school. I can tell you there's a lot of elementary teachers that would say, I don't believe that for a minute. But I do, you know, I get your point. I understand, you know, it's part of that is the negotiation piece. And if I could just also add that from, besides the fact that we bring in research-based curriculum, our teachers are scrutinized. You know, our teachers are observed on a regular basis. Our teachers get a lot of feedback from a number of different people. If you could picture for a moment, my metaphors tend to drift away from education just to make them more valuable, but if you could imagine for a moment a crew, you know, building a skyscraper, and you have your master builders and you have your apprentices, and then you've got folks who are supervising those crews who are constantly watching, constantly saying, well, why did you do this instead of this? You know, to explain why you did this in your classroom. What were you thinking? Did you get the results you were hoping? If you taught this lesson again, what would you do differently? Now, certainly, you know, if you make a mistake on a skyscraper, you could pay for it big time, right? When something comes apart, and in the classroom, you don't see that kind of, you know, coming apart. But certainly, we want our teachers to be accountable to making sure that every student is a learner. And sometimes I know that my teachers will come to me and say, I've got a kid who's just, you know, his reading is third grade, they're really still struggling. I need some extra support. And that can be other faculty, or sometimes that teacher will say, hey, I want to attend this conference because I think I can learn something here that'll help my class this year now. So really it's a lot of pieces that come together around what makes a school sort of cutting edge. It's partly getting that research-based curriculum. It's partly having excellent supervision and evaluation and feedback, having conversations with your staff about their craft.
What's your average time per classroom that you observe?
That's a really hard question to answer. I mean, I do informally. My goal is to be in every classroom every day. Sometimes some classrooms, you know, take my time up more than others. But for formal observations, for most teachers, we try to do at minimum contractually, there's two observations per year that are formal with formal written feedback. And then I'll do, you know, several others per class that's informal with teachers. But certainly the time that we spend just popping into classrooms, having a seat and observing is all valuable evaluation time for me. Contractually, there are certain things we have to put on paper, but you know, whether it's in the classroom or, you know, in a specialist classroom or in PE, you know, whatever the case might be, our job is to be there watching all the time. And it's not just me. These days, more than ever, there's a matrix. Our curriculum coordinators are very involved in supporting teachers and what they do and spend time in their classrooms as well. So teachers in this district anyway get a lot of attention.
Yeah.
And you know, we're watching and we're talking and, you know, it's quality improvement on a daily basis.
Say, speaking of curriculum coordinators, how do you see them driving costs? Like, what do they bring to the table in terms of new curriculum, and what are the associated costs with that? Do you bucket them?
Mm-hmm. I can speak to that. My predecessor had two audits done of our curriculum and our programs here at Union 38 and Frontier Regional. And what these audits came up with were increasing differentiation, looking at those students who are struggling to learn, and different things that would impact our lowest learners, but also our highest, our gifted students. That's where the curriculum coordinator comes in. She took that information with the other curriculum coordinator and the early childhood, and they came up with a program together, and they also developed the early release days that we now have. And through that, they came up with the I'm sorry. It's another superintendent. They're talking about tomorrow. So that's how we develop our professional development. The curriculum coordinator uses Title IIA money. That's a grant that is an entitlement grant. The problem, the small piece that we need to talk about is when you look at the increase in the central office percentage, part of that salary for both the early childhood person and the curriculum coordinator, the curriculum coordinator, part of her salary came from Title I, which has shrunk, and the early childhood coordinator was receiving her salary from a kindergarten grant, which went away. So we don't have that money. So that money was pushed, those salaries were pushed on to the central office because they come out of the central office. So when it looks like our costs went up, it's because we lost grant funding. But they certainly do drive the curriculum. They brought in our social-emotional curriculum, our anti-violence, our anti-bullying curriculum, second step. They monitor. Not only do they bring it in and then make sure that these teachers are up, you know, constantly updating what they're doing and working together and learning, but then they go into the buildings and monitor. So she's in here monitoring that these, that this high level of practice is happening.
And also the other critical piece for them is the assessments. They drive the assessments, both formal and informal assessments. And what we spent the past 2 years as an administration and then flowing down into the schools is aligning our assessments. So with the standards, with the switch to the standards-based report card, that has taken a huge amount of work upon the curriculum directors to make sure that everyone's assessments are the same with a standards-based. So we're trying to make sure that we align our assessments so that if teacher A has the same expectation for exceeds expectation as teacher B does. And it doesn't become a personalized thing. It becomes a standards-based assessment as well as a standards-based report card. And I know that both at Frontier and the union, that has been a huge focus for 2 years, at least minimum 2 years, trying to get us switched over to the standard-based report card and getting everybody trained and everybody having an understanding of what those standards mean.
The difference is instead of you get an A in reading, now it's five or six different standards. You can tell the main character, you can understand the author's purpose, and those are the discrete strands that we now, those are the standards that we now grade. It's very specific, and then are they meeting it, exceeding it, approaching it? So it's a little different than just saying, oh yeah, A in reading, because you can read really well.
Well, I do know that curriculum coordinators exact change in the school system. And I guess that the curiosity would lead one to ask, those changes over time all have costs. What are those costs? And do those costs translate into a better world, a better teaching environment? And does that go for teachers as well as for students? And because they're so fragmented in here, it's something that draws the inquisitive mind right away. You see the term, and you see a lot of, you see costs here and there, but you never see a bucket for them. And
Can I take a stab at that from a financial perspective, having been in bigger districts? I think that we save a lot of money by having the curriculum directors that we do have. Coming from a bigger system, when you hear curriculum director, they're just directing people below them. These people, our curriculum director, are the boots on the ground. So where instead of where we would, they would say, we're going to do this, and then they'd hire people to train the teachers. Our curriculum directors aren't doing that. They're the ones that are training.
And I hope to God they never do.
No, they wouldn't. We couldn't afford it. So that's what this is the best bargain model that I've seen, being in three very different districts. I love this model because it does save money. And not just that, they're doing the training, they're developing the professional learning communities within each school so that there is lead teachers, that there are teachers, like as Pete was describing, grade level leaders that, that get together with the other three schools. And our curriculum director drives all that, starts those conversations, meets with these people. She's never in our office. She has a desk there, but we rarely see her because she's in the schools every day. And to me, that is invaluable. And when I've seen in bigger districts where there's layers where we plan the activities, but we hire people to do the training, we hire people to implement, this is one-stop shopping.
I would, if in fact that's true, which I believe, if you believe it's true, then I believe it's true. But that kind of an explanation, I would think, would be something that you would want to broadcast to the public, to individuals who are wondering, when I send my child here, is it just skip from one grade to another? Is there any coordination? People, I don't think, realize that.
Mm-hmm.
And I think when you see it, someone, when you see the term curriculum coordinator here, it's just, it's in the cloud.
Well, as you
it's
know,
like any other, right. It's like any other job in this school that is not in that classroom.
Right.
People probably don't appreciate it. And it may impact on students leaving.
So every time, since I've come, I think every year the superintendent and I have tried to give more and more information in our budget documents. Right now, I think that we give a great explanation of how we spend our money. The next step that I'm hoping with Dr. Carey that we achieve is that we describe what we're doing with the money, which would mean that each principal would be writing up their perspective of what did we achieve last year? What are we achieving? What do we do every day? I think that needs to be the next part of the budget, is who we are and what we're doing with the money that you're giving us.
If we're giving you money and you're giving money to those curriculum coordinators to change the curriculum or improve the curriculum, somebody's got to know about that.
Mm-hmm.
Somebody's got to, it's got to be on the front door. It's got to be out there that this school is driving this way with this curriculum because of these needs. And those are the kind of things that sets, I think, would set a school apart and would set a community apart, and part of the reason I'm here.
I look at it maybe a little bit different. You know, if I'm sending my kid here, if you're talking about bringing school choice kids in, is that, if that's where you're leaning towards with what you're talking about,
I mean,
the average place is, I want my kid to be going to a safe place for a good education, whether it's school choice or our own kids coming here. I think sometimes I think we're micromanaging too much. If we're starting to break more and more things apart, the average person that brings their kid here probably doesn't care about the curriculum coordinator, because we're doing, you know, they're doing the job. I mean, I guess I'm saying it wrong, but I'm just, to have it on the front, I'm just saying, on the front door or anywhere,
well,
or something, I know, it's hypothetical, but I'm just saying it's.
Yeah, so I mean, first of all, you ask really incisive questions, which caused me to write down a lot of notes, which is good. I like that. But I sense a theme, and I last week at the Finance Committee, you also talked to the high school about, you know, what sets our high school apart, and if you know that we are set apart, if you feel good about what we're doing, promote it, put it out there, right? Didn't I hear that theme
Absolutely.
The other night last
yeah.
week? And I think that you and I are very much on the same page when it comes to remembering, or being forced to remember, that public school is now part of a market, and people do have choices. And we have to market what we do. And just like if you go to buy a car, just to get back to your point, if you go to buy a car, you don't know everything about a car or what's under the hood, but if the salesperson starts to tell you more about it and says, you know, well, this engine does X, Y, and Z, and this suspension is good for that, You're right. Most parents don't think about those intricacies, but when the salesperson tells you about it and gives you a pitch, you feel like, oh, I feel like I'm getting some value for my money here.
Absolutely.
So if what I'm hearing is that we need to do a better job of really letting our public and our communities know who we are and what we do, I'm with you 100%. I think that if we spotlighted someone like our, I can't speak for our secondary curriculum director, she's a wonderful person and does a great job, but I work much more closely with our elementary person. And I think if we spotlighted her in our newsletters or something, I think we could probably do 3 or 4 spotlights in a row month to month, because their job is huge. And besides what you already heard, you know, they run all of our grade level meetings. They do map our curriculum. They do make decisions with teachers about what instruction will be delivered and how much time will be spent on this versus that. And you're right, parents don't know all of that.
They don't.
I'm lucky that I get to meet with them once a month, and we discuss everything that's coming up and what we're doing and share ideas and see what's going on. But if you go back to my narrative, it says, and I need to put more detail in it, I think, for next year, but we provide the highest quality educational experience for our students. And I believe that. I wouldn't have written it if I didn't. And our schools are well regarded and are looked to as leaders in Massachusetts. In this area, Frontier Regional, and our elementary schools are very well regarded, and they are leaders because we are kind of on the forefront. We're a little
forward. What makes
you
say that?
Yeah, what do you think about that?
Well, right now, our early childhood director, Kim McCarthy, she's serving at the state right now to develop our preschool curriculum. She was chosen to serve at the state level. So she's looked to, because they look at our model programs. They're looking at our children coming out of preschool. How kindergarten ready are they? They surpass kindergarten ready when they're coming out of our preschools. Our programs are that well run. And so they're looking at that and saying to Ms. McCarthy, how do we replicate that in every school district? Mm-hmm. So she's serving in that capacity.
But
so
you know as well as I do, Patty, that unless somebody picks this tape up and listens to what you just said, no one knows Kim McCarthy's out in Boston. No one knows, very few people. You may know in this little circle right here, mm-hmm. but the community out there, they don't know.
But to get back to it, Paul, and I know it's important, but do they really care?
Yes.
I mean, you know what I'm saying? Your kids go to school here.
Yeah.
I'm just saying, the average person, the average taxpayer, whether we have kids or not, how many of them, I'm not going to say they care, but do they, you know,
that's not even a question you should ask. Not even a question that a school committee person should even put on the floor, as far as I'm concerned.
But the average person, I tell you what, the average person doesn't know Kim. They don't know Pete. I mean, how much more do we put out there to try, you know, to put them on the forefront? Put Pete on, how much more can we do other than school committee meetings being broadcast, right? How many people actually watch it? When's the last time you watched a school committee meeting?
Well,
and it's free. It's free. I mean,
I mean, I think you've raised some really good points. I think parents do care in general. They just are really busy and they don't have a lot of time. And communication is always hard to get the word out. I think how you evaluate the schools and what do you point to say this is what makes this a really quality school, like Kim going to do that work is great, but my kids aren't in preschool anymore. And so what do I think about as the kids move up the ladder? What do we point to say this is a really quality experience? I mean, there are a lot of choices out there right now, mm-hmm. especially where we are. And they're not great choices necessarily. People don't want to have to make them, but sometimes they do. And we need to, first of all, retain as many people as we can and potentially try
That's
and attract
key.
More.
That's
and
key.
Whately should have more people with families moving in here. We should have, this is a gem of a school, but mm-hmm. they don't think of that the school as a real attraction, I don't think, right now.
Are you talking about like school choice?
I would disagree with that because our numbers bear that out. I mean, we take in five, six times more school choice kids than Levar.
But they're not moving to Whately.
Well, they're not moving to Whately, but I think that's also an economic and a town issue in terms of how much housing costs here and how much housing.
I'm just saying, the more you can promote it, and the more, the better the school can become.
I mean, I
think there's a lot of reasons why people don't move to Whately.
When I think of Whately, I don't think of Whately as a starter community where a young couple looking to start buy their first home, that Whately's in their price range. So I think we're getting our students here in Whately older, and I don't think there is a lot of housing turnover in Whately either.
No, but.
But just the point of being average, I don't think we ever want to be average. Mm-hmm. And the average person, family in this town probably is just going to keep sending their children here. And it's not the average people that pull their kids out of school and send them to either a charter school or private school or school of choice. Those are not the average people. And it's those people that get into conversations with other people who are average. And the conversation comes up, why are you sending your kid to Smith Academy? Why are you sending your kid to the Chinese immersion school? Why? And the average person who's in town doesn't have anything to come back. Oh, I can't afford it. Well, that's not the reason. Well, yeah, that is a big reason, but that shouldn't be the only reason. They should be able to come back and say, well, I'm not going to send my kids because, have you seen the curriculum in Whately Elementary School? My gosh, they take kids from kindergarten, they move them into reading, they've got social, economic, got all kinds of programs for them there. It's moving kids along the continuum. I'm not going to take my kid out of there to send him someplace where I don't know the teachers, I don't know the school committee, I don't know anybody there, but yet they're still doing it.
I don't think we're going to stop it, Paul. The people
course,
that
I really, know you don't think I so, mean, Bob, because I, you're not, because you're not, you don't,
well,
right.
I do
you're not that,
that
guy
time.
That's going to stop it. I get you.
Well, can I say something, Paul? I think you're overreacting on them, first of all, that I don't think we're losing that many kids. And the kids that we're losing aren't all because of the curriculum. There are a lot of factors why parents choose to pull their kids out besides curriculum. It may be that they have a conflict in a class with another student or a group of students, that might be an issue. And when you only have one class at each grade level, those kind of things do happen, Paul.
No,
and that's
question.
A reality, and people have that in their workplace. They
many
move
many.
On because they can't get along with their fellow employees. But I will challenge anybody. I think Whately has a terrific education here. And I think we do a great job. And I agree that we need to promote it more. But to say that we're average, I would never say that.
I didn't say that. You didn't say that. Bob said that.
I don't think that's what Bob meant.
When we look at the high school, this is where we really hurt, the middle and high school. Not a lot, but this is where we see it. Parents who leave, when we talked about this last week, it's kind of the grass is greener. However, when you look at, piece by piece, everything in the high school, every family looks at something different. So I spoke with a mother who is actually planning on running for the school committee. Well, her daughter's really into the arts, and she's really into the dramatic arts and the musical arts. And we had a long discussion. Our program is fantastic. We have a wonderful arts program. We have a wonderful visual arts. We have a wonderful performing arts program. We have 11 AP courses. We also have virtual high school. The students can literally take any class they want if we don't have it. If they want zoology or oceanography, we can offer that in our building. And it's not all about the sports, but we do have a great sports program. However, our arts are really moving up quickly to catch up with that. Granted, the Chinese immersion school, will, you know, we don't have the Chinese. We don't have that kind of focus. The performing arts, well, they get 3 weeks off in the middle of the year. They're not a public school, so they take 3 weeks off and they do some kind of whatever, in-depth thing, whatever they do. We're still a public school, but when we compare public school to public school, Frontier's got it. I mean, we have the whole package. We have great teachers. We are thinking outside the box. We have wonderful programs. We have debate club. We have every club you could think of, ski club. The place this weekend, please come to the play. It's Guys and Dolls, and I think it's going to be wonderful. It's the first musical we've had in many, many, many years. The children are psyched. These are great students. They come into my office. They talk to me. They film me. They're just great kids. Our social studies department, you know, there's debates and lectures. They were so involved, those students, around the election time. There's so many things that we do. We also have Netherlands, students from the Netherlands coming. And now our students are leaving in a couple weeks to go to the Netherlands to see that school. We have, European, the kids can go to Europe. We've done some wonderful, our high school is, I would say to you, a leader in the Western Massachusetts. We really are. And I personally am very proud. And I've spent most of my career as a high school guidance counselor, so I can tell you, the options in this school are great, and students are successful. We can't compete with Deerfield Academy, but I would argue that our students would have the same in-depth learning. They probably wouldn't have as many opportunities as Deerfield Academy, but for any public high school, we can offer anything. We can offer more than anything, more than most schools. And our kids come out as critical thinkers. They write across the curriculum all the time, and that's the most important thing. We start them very young writing, and writing is, that's what they value on the SATs, that's what they value in college, being able to express yourself articulately. So, yeah, I agree with you. We need to be selling ourselves. This is a fantastic, personally, when I was hired, I just couldn't believe how, I was thrilled, because this is an amazing place. But I think people, yeah, Frontier's great, but they don't really know the details. And I think parents don't know the details. So when they say, well, I want to leave because I want my child to have more exposure to whatever. Well, we can offer that, you know, come and look. We can personalize anyone's education. We really have the opportunity. We have the staff, the faculty, and our administration. Curriculum coordinators right on down through kindergarten. We can do it.
I believe you can do it.
Mm-hmm. I'm serious.
We need to hear about it.
I agree.
I think that's the point that I'm hearing from you tonight, Paul. I can tell you, I remember my first year here, I remember the parent who came to see me to say that they were taking their kid to another school. it was the dad in this particular situation. I won't name names, but the dad said, started to hem and haw a little bit, and then told me all the great things about this school. And then I said, then why are you going? And believe it or not, it was the answer was simple. We want a bigger environment. We think that the small classroom with the same kids from one year to the next with very little change just doesn't work for our kid, you know? And it was just, and I was heartbroken. I hated to see the kid go. And since then, however, I've seen lots of people come and lots of people go. And I understand that parents come and go and move their kids for a variety of different reasons. Some good reasons, some, you know, one would question those reasons. I just want to tell you, I heard of a study. It was probably an NPR story. It was probably a few months ago. And it was a study of parents who had preschool kids. And they were asked across the country, what is the most important thing for you at a school? And the top two answers were location, because I need the convenience to get them there, and I want to know that they're going to love and care for my kids, was the other answer. Mm-hmm. Right? Now, I'm sure they also had concerns about how do you teach writing, reading, et cetera, socialization, social skills. But people make decisions for a lot of different reasons. But your point's not lost on me. I'm taking some notes. I agree with you. We need to do a better job of really spotlighting our staff. We need to let the community know who they are. We need to let the community know when they're involved in other things, the good things that they do, the larger organizations that they're a part of, how they may be networking with their colleagues to improve their practice, what we learn and bring into the schools. I don't know what I would do without a curriculum coordinator. I mean, if as principal I had to also be the curriculum coordinator, something would have to give, you know? But that's true with everybody's job. If your boss gives you more to do. You have to find something else to cut out. But, you know, totally invaluable what they do for us. But your message isn't lost on me. I think there's more in common here, even though we have some disagreements. I think we have more in common than, you know, than our disagreements. I feel like we all want just that, exactly what you said. We want to be the best we can be, and I can tell you that in this school, sharpening the saw is something that we focus on a regular basis. And we do need to let them know what we're doing and who we are. So that we keep people here in our town and that we attract other families.
You have to have people, if they decide they don't want this environment, they should all know what they're leaving behind.
Yes, sir. Agreed. Mm-hmm.
And I don't think they do.
I appreciate you giving us a chance to talk about how wonderful our schools are. Usually our meetings are more facilities and these kinds of things, you know, budgets and facilities. But we don't spend enough time.
That's what we pay for. See, that's what you're talking about right now is what we really pay for. That's what the 1.6 whatever is all about. It's not about desks, lights, and it's that. And if we're not seeing that on the outside, the value's being lost.
Well, thank you for giving me the opportunity to speak.
I won't kill it anymore.
Thank you.
Okay,
yeah. I enjoyed it.
Yes, sir.
I got something to interject. One of the big pushes over at the Recorder this year has been to promote local schools. So if we can do that, if we can offer our services, and even if it's like a weekly thing or a monthly thing or whatever it is, in the form of a newsletter or whatever that is, we're happy to provide our services in that way. So.
You and I will continue to talk. Andy's already done some really nice work for us here at the school at different times, and that kind of press is great for us. Yeah,
it's good to see the press here. I guess I'm taking a hit shot at you because we rarely see the press. So that message doesn't get in the newspaper.
It's an odd week, so you know, we usually get it last week.
We don't take enough time to talk about, and in the same way when I can email Andy any day, most of the time we email back and forth, I don't think to say, you know, all the wonderful things. It's...
Well, you say it, I'll put it in.
Thanks, Andy.
There you go.
So, and just for so we know, I just looked up our school attending, that reports all children. So only 20% of our children attend private, charter, or choice, or homeschool. 20% of the all Whately students between ages probably 5 through 18. Mm-hmm. So 20% are being educated elsewhere besides here at Whately, the Frontier, and Franklin County Tech.
But you have to understand, the perception is that's the top of the mountain. Okay? That's an improvement. Okay. Improvement for what? I bet they can't answer that because they don't know what they're leaving behind. They don't know what they're not going to get by staying here.
But at the of the 20%, what is the reason? Like, you know, it's the father looking for a larger classroom or the private school or the Chinese immersion, which we can't touch the private school. So if there's out of the 20%, how much is it private school that we were going to lose more than likely because that's how some of these families are. They, at a certain age, after sixth grade, isn't it? After sixth grade, when they go to seventh, we lose them to private schools, typically?
Only eight students from Whately go to in-state, private, or parochial schools.
Out of how many, what's the total number?
177 children in Whately.
Yeah.
Eight attend private, two are homeschooled, and then we have 19 out of district publics and 7 charter.
And there's a far greater need than to convince children, or it's the rest of the population. It's the rest of the taxpayers. If the taxpayers all feel like this is a high quality place, that something's happening here, and they know about it and they hear about it, it's far easier to sell a $1.6 million budget year after year after year. I mean, not that it's been hard the past few years, but I don't know if that will continue.
You think it's too easy, Paul? I mean, over the last 10 years for budgets, you see what happens on the floor there when we're talking about the budgets. The average, I'm gonna go back to average. The average person, they don't wanna ask any questions. We're all there to answer questions. We try to answer them, but no one has questions for us. It's like having a school committee meeting and no one comes to ask us questions other than you tonight, but that's what happens.
It's what happens because people don't feel comfortable in that kind of forum for the most part. And they don't do their homework for the most part. And so you really have to put it out there. And so that it's an understood fact.
Like a slide presentation that's at Tommy, I mean, we could put on a slide presentation with all our things that's going on
sure.
to sell our $1.6 million budget, but...
Well, word of mouth is very powerful, I think, in a community, and I think Paul's right, that going to those meetings, a lot of people are very intimidated in those meetings, but that doesn't mean they're not talking about it outside of the... And they don't come to these meetings, but we should be really pushing a lot of more positive information.
Yeah.
And listening, I guess, is the other thing I wanted to say. For the people that are leaving, you know, when they come and talk to you, and we've had lots of conversations about this, is to really listen to what people are saying and try. We can't accommodate everybody. We can't do every program that everybody wants to see, but I don't know if the schools are listening fully. I really appreciate you making a very big point about this because I'm not sure the schools are really paying attention. Like, there's a lot of talk about this out there.
There's a lot of talk, and you know, schools are no different than any other, whether you want to call it private, corporate environment. Once you get in these walls, this is where life is, and life kind of stays here. And you're so busy every day with everything you got to do that the outside world is there we can get to it.
The only thing I'll add to that, and it doesn't change the outcome, because the outcome, I'm with you 100%. We need to do a better job in making sure that our community and beyond knows all the good things that we do. But I would also remind you that a lot of the people on that list, they never come here. They don't come and leave. They start in kindergarten, and we never see them, you know?
Right. But that's why? We should ask why. We should say, why don't they give it a chance?
Well, we could, but I mean, certainly we could, but that would be, at least for this school, I think, unprecedented. I don't think you ever did it in your time where you reach out to a resident who's going to a private school or a charter school for kindergarten and ask them, why did you choose that over us? I suppose we could.
But these are changing times.
Interviews are one thing, but the kids we never see because their parents put them in Northampton schools at kindergarten, that's a different story.
I do think there is some value in getting the data, but I think when we try to get the data, we just say why. And so parents are at a loss. I think that if we'd spent some time and came up with a good survey where we could say, do you see it as this or that, we might be able to narrow it down.
The question is, what would keep you here, really?
What can we do differently?
That is a constructive question that might produce some interesting...
And some of the answers might have been, gosh, if I only knew that about your school.
Right.
And so, our proactive approach.
If I knew the curriculum at this school was X, Y, and Z, if I knew that by grade 4, my child should be performing or be proficient in these skills, and that by grade 7 they would be, you know, more than ready to take on middle school and high school because of everything that they learned along the way. And I think some people just assume that that's going to happen. Some people don't care that's going to happen. And others really do care, and I think it's important.
It's true, and we do great things all the time. Tomorrow would have been, because of the snow, were canceled, Pi Day at 8th grade, and Pi meaning figuring out Pi, the mathematical symbol, and the students were going to spend the whole first part of the morning figuring out Pi on many different items and in different rooms, and they're going from room to room with 3D and all kinds of different ways to figure out pi on all kinds of different things. Then they're going into the auditorium and they're watching. Now, this is a documentary. It's a very high quality mathematician, and how that person, way back before, I don't know, written times, had come up with, and I forget the guy's name, but he had come up with some heavy duty original, really original thinking on math. And then they took a, and they printed a Bible over this book, and they're erasing, they're in the process now of erasing it and finding all of these really intricate mathematical discoveries from ancient times. And the students are going to learn about that, and then they're going to come back, and then they will be probably enjoying some pie as well. But they will have spent a marathon of
after all that pie.
A marathon of figuring out, you know, how do you figure out the pie of this, or how do you make pie? And really, these are the kinds of, not sitting in a classroom lecturing and then doing a worksheet. These kids will never forget that experience. Oh, remember we went over there and we had the goop and we were making pie with the goop, or we had the box and we were, you know, cutting out and figuring out, or we had this item. That's the kind of guided discovery that these kids will never forget. And it really cements their learning. It's not just sitting in, you know, and we have these kinds of things happening all the time. I just did one in geography with our life skills students, and it was wonderful. And the parents were there, and it was in the middle of the day. So you're right. We do need to start advertising what we're doing. Mm-hmm. And the fact that our grade 10 MCAS scores in math are extraordinarily high. I'm so impressed. Our MCAS scores in math in grade 10 are just outstanding.
I guess I could have found that, but
right.
I'm not sure where.
And we're a level 2 school, which is pretty decent. You know, we do have one level 1 school, but level 2 is nothing to be.
Who's a level 1 school?
Conway Grammar.
Conway.
They are a level 1 school, but we're only this much away from them, mm-hmm. as far, Whately especially, as far as is reaching that level 1 status. We do knock it out of the park. We do. And our kids go to college, and they go to great colleges. I've had some wonderful dinners with some of these kids that have been awarded. We are having two of our teachers in the union, one in the union and one at the middle school, that are earning the Grimspoon Award for Pioneer Valley Excellence in Teaching. So we are doing great.
That's
things.
What we want to hear. And I don't know how to be more direct, but I don't want to spend $1.6 million for average. That's all I'm going to say.
And level 3 would be average. We're level 2 on our way to level 1.
And that's what we got to hear.
I will definitely work harder on that piece, because I could go on and on.
Okay. I've got some good ideas too.
Okay, I'm done. Sorry.
Thank you.
I'm sorry about the.
No, don't be sorry. This is good.
I don't see it that way.
At least you showed up. I'm happy.
All right. Any other discussion on the FY18 budget? If not, then I'll close the hearing and open the school committee. And the first order of business is to review and approve the minutes of February 6th and 14th.
Second.
I have to abstain from the 14th. Okay. I wasn't there. And Katie
I wasn't
there
either. Either.
Can we?
How do we do it?
Yeah.
We can't vote on it. Only one person was there.
Well, you didn't have a quorum.
Yeah, we didn't take any votes, so really we don't need to. It'd be part of the record. The minutes would be part of the record.
Move so we'll approve the minutes from February 6th. Then.
Okay.
Second.
Any discussion? All in favor?
Aye.
Financial statement and warrants. Patty.
Okay, so you have 7 warrants that you signed this evening, and they totaled $31,289.16. I'm continuing to watch a couple of areas that we've previously discussed. in particular our sped transportation, and our we had a long-term sub situation. Right now, we are short in our budget. These are overriding, plus some offsetting savings with a difference in our occupational therapist who left mid-year. We need about $5,457 to cover these shortages. And I am looking at, on page two, the salary and subline. We've got right now, at the end of February, $11,438.50 left. So I think we'll be able to cover those savings there because most of our, besides March, I mean, December, January, February are our heavy sick months for our teachers. So it looks like we're gonna have a surplus here. So I would be using the savings and the subs to pay for the overages in sped transportation and the long-term subs. For long-term subs, we don't usually charge that to the subline. The subline is usually our day-to-day subs only. But in this case, I think we can most appropriately use the sub to pay for the long-term sub.
Where do you charge the long-term sub?
Yeah.
To the
but you don't charge it there. Where do
to
you
to the
charge?
Teaching line, because they're truly the they are the teacher of record during that period.
Mm-hmm.
So we do it there, and sometimes depending on what type of long-term absence we have, there could be some savings, because if people are taking an extended leave that's unpaid, we'd mm-hmm. have some savings, and then so we net it against the long-term sub cost.
As long as the long-term sub is not more than what the actual teachers get paid.
That's correct.
On the sped transportation and the other regular transportation, I thought you had said that was going to fund the overages in the sped.
And we're still, I'm still looking at that. Mm-hmm. I'm trying to calculate the fuel cost for the next couple of months. Okay. And I've netted all that in, Katie, and okay. coming up with between the OT savings, the fuel cost savings, we're still going to need about $5,400.
Oh.
So
the
I'm
22
looking at it in totality.
That's left for the regular transit is going to be used? Mostly.
Yes.
And do we not encumber those? Just say, like, based on what you know the contract is or whatever?
Well, so that's part of the problem, that we don't use the purchase order system in Infinite Visions. So uh-huh. The only thing I'm encumbering right now are the salaries, because mm-hmm. I know what they are. And that this is hopefully going to be, we're going to start using it, and then I could put the contract in.
Mm-hmm.
And then we'd know.
We would know better what
exactly.
to expect.
And that's all I have for tonight.
Any other questions? Patty? If not, okay, moving right on. Public comment. Set an upper tonight, or you good?
I have another question.
Okay.
If it's possible. The question regards, and brought it up earlier, and it's a curriculum coordinated decision. Early release. And the optics on that day from the outside looking in. It's a half day. And you call it early release. Look, I taught for 8 years, okay? So I know a little bit about what's going on inside. When you put in lunch and recesses, everything else on early release day, that comes down to a half day. So the optics now are with the elementary school or any of these other schools, it's a 4.5 day week. So the actual instruction time, my child, over the course of a year, you can knock that down by half day a week, boom, 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 boom. Now compare that to what's going on with the competition and whether or not that factors in. What I'm saying is, it's how it looks and how it's perceived. And it's not perceived well. I think it was probably a good experiment, I think. I don't know. I do know that it was originally meant so that teachers would have their actual time to prepare for the students in the next week, but I know what it is. It's another time for meetings, so teachers are pulled out of their classrooms to attend these meeting after meeting, and I gotta tell you, it doesn't look good.
May I speak?
Please.
Thank you. So that perception.
Please say what I want to hear.
The perception is there. I understand that. I also know that all of the school districts around also engage in that, but our early release is an hour and a half early. The students leave at 1:30, so it's not like they're leaving right at noon. What had happened before that we went to the early release model was in the teachers' contracts, they have 4 or 5 days of teacher convention or teacher professional development, or what we would call Teacher's Day. And so the kids didn't come to school at all, and so they didn't get those days. What we've done is taken those days and put them an hour and a half on Fridays. We started out, as far as I know, last year it started out with 30, and now we're down to 26. However, almost 6 of those are parent-teacher conferences when the parents come in and speak to the teachers. So for next year, I asked, when we're making our schedule for next year in our calendar, I asked if we could use November 7th, which is the election day, and use that as a whole day parent-teacher conference. And that went over well. We would also be training our instructional assistants, because by contract they need to have 6 sessions of training as well. We get 4 done on that day. What happens during that time is a good question. What happens is when we talk about our forward teaching strategies, all of the other things that we talked about earlier, the differentiation, the technology, using technology in teaching, how you do your grade book as far as understanding those abstract standards based. We're changing up, it's a paradigm shift from A, B, and C to actually, are you meeting the standard? Are you getting there? All of this higher level work is being done on those hour and a half Fridays. So it's really the work that makes the district run or the schools run. It's the work that makes the students, it's the work that filters down to the students in higher level instructional strategies. They do meet once every other month or in grade level, but in the grade level meetings, there's an agenda, and the grade levels meet, they follow that agenda, they have an accountability sheet, they account for all their time and the work that they've done. They're working on science with the Hitchcock Center in Amherst. We're doing some really high-level science with our new science state frameworks. Our science is pretty exciting. Our students are engaging in STEM and engineering, which is a very important thing. All of this training happens during these hour and a half days. They're very, very busy. The teachers, I think, respond very well. They take advantage of the time. I personally was there on Friday, and I was amazed at the professionalism, the collaboration, the fact that they were sticking to the agenda, that they had specific goals and action steps that they, when they finished, they knew what they were doing. It's not wasted time by any long or short measure. Some of the students go home, some of the students stay. Unlike our other colleagues or our other districts where they leave at noon, the kids just go home. We keep some of them, if the parents aren't able to take them, we keep them. And we engage those children in meaningful activities because we need to understand, and I just wrote this to the district this afternoon, play is the work of the young. And what they do on these not as formally structured hour and a half Fridays is also very important for their development. It's for their social and emotional development. They are put in positions where they learn and they expand. So they're playing with goop, or they're building cars with lifesavers for wheels. They're doing all kinds of activities like that. In this school, they're sewing. I think they're sewing pillowcases or something for the homeless shelter or something. So I'm trying to keep up on all my schools. So I understand that perception, and maybe that's another piece where I need to really get out there and say, this is not wasted time. This is what makes our teachers the best quality, the highest quality teachers around. All of our other districts are doing the same thing, but not with the least impact on students that we are.
I think it's time to say something about this, mm-hmm. because it's now perceived as this is the new norm. The new norm in terms of a school week here is 4.5 days. I know you say it's only an hour and a half, but instructional time. And that is a perception. And I don't think that's a positive perception. And I don't think that lends to long-term goals of what you'd like to accomplish or how you'd like to be perceived.
From a financial perspective, this model makes the most financial sense. Part of the reason we started looking at this model was because we were spending so much money on substitutes to cover classes because teachers were being pulled out of classrooms to be trained in the new curriculums. So now we're paying our teachers, we're paying subs to cover them, and we're losing continuity of teaching in the classroom because our teachers aren't in front of our students. So this is...
You should see it, Patty.
Pardon?
You should show that. You know, this is our cost.
And I think that...
And now here's our cost, and this is what we say. I mean, I think every finance committee would love to see that.
And I think the other thing, too, is if we didn't use this model, what would be the next thing? How else are we going to provide teaching time, provide professional development time for our teachers? What other way? Well, the easy to most districts do, they add days to the contract. That is just not feasible for us. We can't afford to pay for more than 182 days. We couldn't add two more days. That the cost of that would be astronomical. So this, you know, from my perspective as the business manager, this is the most financially progressive model that we have. So I'm loving it from that our teachers are getting the quality that, and they're still in front of we're still meeting our time on learning. The only reason we could do this was because we were exceeding our time on learning. So we're still above time on learning minimum requirements for the state. And we're doing it financially reasonably at a good cost.
Well, you know how I feel about early release. I think it's really important for us to keep evaluating it and to really connect it to the students and what their value is for the students. There's a lot of value for the teachers, I don't doubt that. They get a lot of resources and a lot of time, but the 4.5 day week is not a positive. It's, you know, that's sending a signal like it's not important for kids to go to school every day, every week. That's the way the kids think about it. And I really want to, again, ask you to listen to some of the feedback that people are trying to give about these things, because you can find people within the district that are going to understand what you're talking about and why it's important, but it's the people outside the district that are going to help the taxpayers that need to understand some of these things and aren't going to be able to interpret it or don't have all the information to interpret them in the same way. And I think tying it to what is the quality, like I love the value question, what is this doing for the students at the end of the day, which is really what the school is here for, is a really good thing to think about.
And I have to say that my thinking on the situation on Fridays have really changed. I was a full supporter of the idea that, you know, it'd be done on a weekly basis, but I think there are far too many days. And I really think that, I hope this will be a discussion in the joint meeting when we discuss calendars, because I really would like to look at that. Mm-hmm. I think they're valuable and it makes sense what Patty's saying. I think you can get the number of hours that teachers need per contract to give them their PDPs. But I think we could reduce the amount of half days and still do a pretty darn good job. And I think that that perception would be far less removed.
Right. So you could do a monthly real half day, which, you know, is going to be maybe mm-hmm. a little less time, but That would go over, I think, a lot better than every Friday.
I think that that's very, very good input, mm-hmm. and I hope that you will feel comfortable bringing that up next month. We want to do what's best, but we want to do what's best for the kids, the teachers, and our communities that support us.
And it's not, I mean, the perception is it's every Friday, but it really isn't every Friday.
Well, it is.
Well, I don't know. And that's confusing, too, honestly. Like, are we having it this Friday now that we're closed tomorrow?
I put out the word we are. We are. I haven't told the families yet.
See, it was.
But I told the teachers.
From my point of view.
Everybody knows.
Originally, it was said that if there was a
snow day,
there would be no Friday. And now it's swung that it's going to be Friday. It's happened twice now.
Right. And, at least.
I mean, and then okay, the parents know 2 days ahead of time. So what? They were told originally that it was going to be that way, and then it switched. So then now they're scrambling, and they're saying, well, where do I find my babysitter? I hope grandma and grandpa are available because we need them.
If it was Wednesday afternoon, the perception wouldn't be as severe. But Friday's Friday to begin with. Come on. Those are the days of movies, slides.
Oh, yeah.
And,
the old days.
That's the old days. Yeah. But people, we are from the old days. That's what we. So now, Friday plus, you're going to knock off an hour and a half, but you put in recess and lunch, and it's really a half day of
not very much time.
And readers and
do you know that when we were looking at this model in other school districts in Franklin County, they had actually done accounting that their attendance on Friday for teachers improved with this model. So I think we need to take a look at that and say,
yeah.
Hey, did our attendance on Fridays for
exactly.
our teachers improve right. over by doing this?
Mm-hmm.
Well, and also I'd like to look at districts outside of Franklin County and that have gotten rid of this, like Amherst has gotten rid of this recently. Why? What are they finding? Maybe we need to look at both places.
I can ask them.
Was it part of our contract when we did our new contract last time, or is
no.
it just still
no.
two full days of
it was something that administration brought for
but
the does
it, but, yeah but did it equal the 2 days that we were supposed to give them for curriculum days? Not curriculum days.
Well, it was that, and it was also the changing curriculum, the need to really give a lot
we
more support
more
to the students,
the
to the teachers.
If it's everything that you say it is, prove it and advertise it. If you do those two things, that means you're standing behind what you believe, and I think people will fall in line. If not, then maybe your reassessment is in order. Right on.
Got it to more, Pop.
I'm done. I have more, but snow's coming.
All right. Well, keep it for the town meeting.
Yeah, plus there's Frontier. When's the Frontier meeting happening?
22nd now?
Yes.
22nd.
It's supposed to be tomorrow night, but it'll be the 22nd.
Right, yeah.
Unless you want to go tomorrow night. I'll pick you up.
You invite me?
Yeah. Of course I will.
Done.
All right, moving right on. Unfinished business, fire suppression sprinkler system. I understand that we're having a few issues that we need to resolve with the sprinkler system. So you want to fill in the rest of the committee?
Yeah, well, I thought maybe Bob was coming tonight when I saw that on the paper.
I've got it.
You got it? Because it's not problems, it's inspection.
Bob's on vacation,
stuff.
Yeah.
It's a lot of vacation time.
It's not a Friday afternoon. And I didn't say
tomorrow.
That bad.
No. He will be back tomorrow to take care to help us take care of our lizard. So, did you want to speak to it? My notes say we need permission to spend money from the sprinkler account to replace four sprinkler heads and test the sprinklers, some random testing, and I think that was from this. Did you folks get this Hampshire Fire Protection LLC? So
can we back up and just explain kind of what happened? Because I was reading the notes that were sent out ahead of time, and I don't really understand. I don't think we talked about this before.
And so, well, we have.
It's been
a year.
It's been years.
Pre-me issues.
Probably so, pre-me.
So really, there's nothing wrong with the system at the moment. It's okay. Perfectly working condition. The problem is that there are, this is not a good example in here because the sprinklers are all exposed. Same over here. Throughout the building, you'll see little metal plates that cover a sprinkler head. And the way the system works is when it's activated, those sprinkler heads, I think, knock the plates off and do their job.
Okay.
Over the years, a number of those plates have fallen out and they're gone. You know, they've never been replaced.
Okay.
Can't get them anymore, the plates. If you do replace them, this is my layman's understanding, is that you're also going to be replacing the sprinkler heads, right? So for a few years, the inspectors have said, okay, well, if you get that done, that'll be great, you know. This year, they've pressed us on the issue. It hasn't been done in the past. So we need to replace some sprinkler heads, and they're called escutcheon plates that go over them. Mm-hmm. And I guess they're going to do some testing, too. I wasn't aware of that part of it. But if you recall, a few years ago, we had the town approve some money to replace the whole sprinkler system, found out after the fact that it wasn't going to be enough money to replace. Some decisions were made about putting that money in an account with the town, not the school budget, but the town. And as we've had problems with the sprinkler system, we've asked the town to allocate some of that money along the way. My understanding is that there's about $34,000 still available in that account, and this bill is what
$4,502.
So $4,500 to do these things that will suit the inspector from the Franklin Council of Governments.
And I did notify Brian Domina that we would be looking to spend this money from that account once we received approval here to do so.
And that's what the understanding was.
Yes, and that's the extent of it as far as
that. That's all that was.
There's more to it than I'm not aware of it, but I think that's all that there is to it.
I mean, I don't have a problem with it. I mean, it has to be done.
No.
And we do have the account for that purpose.
Do we have to vote on that?
Yes, we do.
Okay.
So I'll entertain a motion.
Make a motion to spend $4,502.31 on four new sprinkler heads and what was the other
part? For the work that needs to be done, just in case.
Just the work that
needs to be done. Let's not do a dollar because that's an estimate.
Okay.
They could get in here and find a couple more that might need to be changed out even though they're there.
Work to be done on the sprinkler system, replace some sprinkler heads.
Second.
Any further discussion? Okay. All in favor? Aye. Okay.
Can I just ask one question on that, though? One question I have is who's responsible for, like, keeping track of these things going forward? Like, it seems like it was a bit of a surprise.
No, it wasn't.
Who should be?
It wasn't a surprise.
Okay.
So when the inspectors, for example, give you another issue that we're dealing with now. So this year, mm-hmm. the inspector decided that our curtain has been hanging there long enough and it must no longer be fire retardant.
Right, like so there's a long list of things.
So he decided that this year we need to prove that it is still fire retardant and or replace it. So now mm-hmm. we're trying to figure out how to make it fire retardant again or uh-huh. show that it still is.
Roll the lighter to it.
And but that's just my example, but over the past couple of years, we've had different inspectors, and some have said, yeah, you really should get that done, but it didn't end up necessarily on their report. So right. this year, it was on the report, and we need to get
it. And who's we? Like, is it you? Are you the one that would be following up on this, or is it Bob? Like, I guess I'm just
both
really asking,
yeah,
like,
both of us
who's
together.
Ultimately responsible for making these things happen?
Both. Yeah, the report from the inspectors usually go to both of us,
okay.
and that's how we were made aware of the issue.
Okay.
So Bob, just to go back to the curtains, just for information only, Bob did get some estimates on the stage curtain. To test and certify the stage curtain for 3 years would be $600. To replace the stage curtain would be between $4,000 and $5,000. Sorry.
Can I ask a question? Other than the looks of what the curtain looks like now, is the curtain used in productions here where you have to open and close in it, and okay, just if we're going to spend, you know, for a new curtain.
We're not buying new curtains, as far as I know. These curtains are perfectly good, and they can be resprayed.
We just need to respray them.
Yeah. And we can get them certified for 3 years for $600. Mm-hmm. And that we'll vote on that next time, I guess, because we didn't put it in here.
I don't think we need to vote on that. No. We're voting on this because it's a fund that the town has.
Good job. Good.
Is there anything, another major thing on that yet?
It was sort of a long list, it seemed like to me, but I don't know if I'm just misinterpreting it.
A couple of the things on the list were that we didn't have inspection certificates to show them, but those were not because we weren't inspected.
That's the state's.
That's partly the state, but the way that it often works is that the people who do our inspections come in, sometimes they tag something, sometimes they don't. Then they go back and they write up their report that they inspected, and they wait for their check to come before they send us the inspection certificate. So when the inspector came in, he said, "Where's your certificate?" And Andy said, "Checked with me," and we looked, and we just didn't have it yet, but they were inspected. So a couple of those were outstanding inspection certificates that we just needed to produce the paper. What else is on that list? I don't remember.
At the state level, they're redoing the way they do boiler inspections, and it's just, it's been a nightmare. So even when we send the check in, then we still gotta hunt them down to get the certificate. Mm-hmm.
So there were some other things that we wanted to talk about, but they're not on the agenda. And those are the light poles that were near the fire that the wires melted, and other light poles on the other side that got water in them and the wires corroded. We do have estimates because while they're working out, repairs have been made. We do have proposals, but it has been suggested we pull all new wiring into these poles. One would be a bill to the town insurance, and the other one would be ours. And we could talk about that at another meeting.
Well, the ones that are billed off to the town's insurance are no-brainers.
I think it's done.
We did get the bill. It's done.
Yeah, the bills for ones are being taken care of, and the most recent bill for the one that wasn't fire-related has already been processed through the PA.
Right.
I think we're done there.
So,
and the light posts, that is.
The emergency lights, okay. Yeah. So, though, that's just for information. And then the phone clock and PA system. So I don't know if you want to, we have two different solutions, but we can talk about that at our next meeting.
Well, those weren't, I think the reason we did that was because we had put a proposal 2 years ago to the town to, on a town warrant article for $30,000, and Mr. Skrosky just asked us to refresh to make sure that $30,000 was still going to be valid. So we're still going to be bidding out the project, but the two things that Scott got was, one was at 35 and one was at 25. So the 30 is good, and I don't think at this point, until it gets approved at the town warrant, we need to move forward until we know, and we can discuss probably in June what Pete's preference is, what we'll be bidding. Because the meeting's in April.
Just to back up, what we're talking about is that 2 years ago, Pete brought up that the sound system and the phone system in the building wasn't being reliant. Mm-hmm. And they were having trouble, and you couldn't trust it all the time. Mm-hmm. So we submitted a capital improvement article to the town of Whately for $30,000 to be put on the list, so we move along as the town does in determining the needs of capital improvement. So it came up again this year, and capital improvement looked at it and looked at it with a high priority. So I suggested to our administration that they revisit that to make sure we had enough money to cover that, because I don't want to ask for $30,000 and find out it's going to cost $50,000.
Right.
And then the project's on hold and the money's sitting there, and you go through a whole different problem. Mm-hmm. So, as she said, it was two quotes, you got 35 and what, 25?
Yep.
So it's kind of right in the middle. So I suggest that, you know, we leave it with the town as is at 30 and see how we go.
And hopefully, through the bidding process, we'll be able to get what we need, and hopefully for a cheaper price.
Mm-hmm.
And it's more, especially the phone system, without having communication is a real safety and...
Yeah, so from a safety, I wanted to just share with you for your education what it is we would like to do, or what I would like to see, the recommendations I made. So our phone system is not only limited in terms of who has a phone, but it's antiquated. We have a voicemail system that, you know, if one person's voicemail fills up, nobody else can get voicemail. So, I mean, it's antiquated. It's been here as long as the building has. Having a phone in every classroom that a teacher can dial 911 from is important to me. And then, of course, they would have their own voicemail available to them. And these days, with the internet and computers, et cetera, we'll have probably unlimited voicemail, so to speak. But also, we have a system in the building right now, which is separate from our phone system. It's called a Bogan system, and it's a phone on the wall in every classroom where if the teacher picks it up, it automatically rings the office. It's also 27, 28 years old, and they were built into cinder block walls, and whenever we've had trouble with those working, it's been because the dust from the cinder, they're not even boxed in. You know, they were installed with an open back. So the contacts on the phone were being affected by just dust from cinder blocks behind them. We can clean them and make them work better again. But that's our only system of communication from classroom to classroom now. So rather than repair two systems, we'd like a phone system that can intercom as well. We're hoping to connect to our current sound system because we do have speakers in almost every room that needs it. I think I recommended two new speakers. Adding two speakers in places where we don't have them, where an emergency call would be important to have. And then we're also looking at the possibility of having clocks included in all this work. Because right now our clocks are all independent. You know, literally somebody had to go around, this is a timely conversation, no pun intended, but somebody had to go around and move all the clocks in the building today to make it, you know, daylight savings time. So if we can get a system similar to what Frontier has, where the speakers, the clocks are digital, et cetera, and the phone system is a good one that works for everybody, and parents can leave messages for individual teachers throughout the building, et cetera, I think we've met some safety needs and we brought ourselves into the 21st century.
I've just got one question. Did you say digital?
Pardon?
Digital. For the clocks?
Oh, maybe not. I mean, whatever.
We are decide. An elementary school. Yeah. We're trying to teach them how to tell time and not just look at numbers.
Right. That's fine. Yeah. That's fine, too.
Are all those included in the quotes that they got?
Yes. And I don't really know what kind of clocks they're including, quite frankly. At that point, I left it to the expert.
I don't think it states. No.
But even if it's a clock with a dial, it ought to be, one that works with a computer and digital in that sense, that it's going to move itself when the time comes.
Because when Whately and Conway both built schools at the same time, I was surprised when I went up to Conway and visited a new school and they had digital clocks. That's a little odd.
And no chance.
And you made sure they had the old-fashioned kind for learning.
Yeah, so I figured it was a good idea that kids actually learn how to
do it. You want us to get phones with a dial on them?
I'd like to dial up phone, too.
They're more expensive now because they're collector's items.
All right. Moving along to the budget. Now that we've had a hearing and we've been before the Finance Committee, and submitted a budget, we need to vote a budget to bring to town meeting. So, with that said, I think Patty made a recommendation that we reduce our budget by $6,000 due to the electrical changes that were made in the building.
Oh, you want to get first?
Yes, I'm good. Something
yeah, the corner of the one I just handed out should say public hearing version number 3.
And the 2.55.
Okay.
And
good.
If you go to page, of course, I'm sorry, Katie, the decrease still says decrease, but when I reprint them, you'll see that I am page 7 of 27. We add a decrease in the utilities, electricity, $6,000, bringing the net change to $40,802 or 2.55% increase.
You guys okay with that?
Yes.
Yeah. That's good.
Thank you. Is there anything else you want to discuss or change in the budget before we vote? Nothing?
Okay.
I'll entertain a motion to accept the budget.
Make a motion to accept the FY18 budget revised, the version 3 public hearing.
Second.
And the amount is, Patty?
You would be voting a budget.
$1,640,256.
$1,640,256 from the town appropriation.
For the town appropriation.
Okay, any further discussion? All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Okay, we have a budget to move on.
Thank you.
All right. I think we're to reports, aren't we? Oh, enrollment numbers, okay, good.
All right, so I will do, this will be combined with my principal's report, because I have one other item to give you. Meetings, yes, you have those already.
Yep.
And I'm happy to share one with you two as well. These I did not hand out to you yet. Just wanted to hold on to that until I could explain it to you. Thanks. So the first form, the one that says Whately enrollments anticipated school choice, is a form you've seen before, but it's slightly different than the last time, so I'm just going to try to walk you through it and make sure you understand each part of it. So the part of this that's different is if you look at target size for classroom, all right, so just to do a little background work here. So target, our classroom size targets were established by this school committee many years ago. And the principal, whoever that principal is in this school, is charged with trying to keep our classroom sizes within that target size, 18 to 20 per classroom. Now, what I've done in my whole time here, and this year may be an exception, is that I've really tried to keep the younger grades at 18 and no more. So in other words, if we had, you know, 14 kids in a grade and we got six applicants, I might only take four for that grade so that we end up with 18. Because classrooms can grow, you know, as they go through the grades, new people come to town, whatever, classrooms can grow. So in order to keep reasonable sizes in line with what school committee wants, I've really tried to keep our youngest grades at a lower number. And now these days that's not too hard because, as you know, with kindergarten, so let me just switch over now to that first column, anticipated class size. So the town of Whately is going to be sending us, looks like, about seven kids from our town. All right, and that's part of the reason our classroom sizes are small, is that our population doesn't send us a lot of students, you know, for kindergarten. So we have seven students that have taken home registration paperwork. We also have received six school choice applications for kindergarten. And that's how you want to read this form. So the second column just gives you an idea of how many openings I would have in that grade. And this year I'm using some, you know, ranges, because depending on where we land with our total number of school choice kids across the grades, and with the support of school committee, I would be, you know, I would be happy to take more kids in the younger grades if our overall numbers, you know, feel like we, you know, have room for more children in the building. So in other words, if I did get in, you know, in second grade, seven applicants, right? Right now in second grade, we have 13 students going into second grade next year. So in theory, if I got seven applicants, I could take five and cap it at 18, which some years I might do because maybe we have more kids coming to kindergarten and more kids coming to upper grades, or I could choose to take as many as 20 in those grades. That's part of the reason why I gave you the second sheet, because I wanted you to see a quick retrospective, and I think I gave mine all away. Maybe you can look along with me. Thank you, this will work. But I wanted to just give you a quick retrospective of what our school choice numbers have looked like since FY09. We have some records in the building that where you see double numbers, like under FY15 and FY16, that's just because on those years I happened to have the paperwork where, as our school choice numbers changed during the year, I was able to see some changes that happened during the year. I'm sure they happened in FY09, 10, 11, 12, etc., but I don't have the paperwork. I'd have to dig a little deeper to find out. But just to give you an idea, that's what our nine-year average looks like in terms of school choice. You know, so you can see it's gone up and down. The numbers in red are just the extremes. You know, 52 has been the highest in the past 9 years. 38 has been the lowest, and that's this year. That's where we are now with school choice. So that's a dip. But relatively speaking, we've averaged about 47 school choice kids per year over the past 9 years. Right? Now, if we're building a budget around these numbers and we want to try to maintain some school choice numbers, then that clearly is going to influence how many school choice acceptances I'm going to put out there. The first part of the equation, of course, is how many will we get? With your blessing a couple of years ago, we started to advertise our school choice openings. We have again this year. We just did two weekends in the Gazette and the Recorder, and then we've also put up a school choice opening advertisement in the Hilltown Families website and newsletter. So I do anticipate that over the next couple of months, we're going to get more school choice requests. But at the moment, if you look in the third column, that's what we have. We have six for kindergarten, and one in first grade and one in second grade.
Pete, can we go back to this for a second? Yeah. What is the second line this graph?
So the second line, I'm sorry, I didn't explain that. That's just how many we graduate each year, how many school choice kids on the average will graduate.
Oh, so this is the number leaving sixth grade?
Leaving sixth grade, yeah. I included that because, obviously that's a built-in, right? As soon as we graduate them, we got to replace them, right? So some years, as you can see, again, the outliers there are 1 year we graduated 10 kids. This year we're graduating 9. Last year we graduated 6. But I just wanted to give you a sense that, with part of the formula is that every year we're going to lose a bunch, and at the very least we want to replace that bunch, because again, our budget's built on it. And I also think it's a salient conversation because I know that some of the schools around us are doing the opposite, where they feel like, gosh, we have a whole classroom worth of students and a teacher, and so we're going to roll back our school choice. And I just want to make it clear that that's not the situation here. With these school choice numbers, and even more, we're still at what I think is an excellent number for classrooms.
You're trying to sell me on the idea that to take more school choice kids, I don't have a problem with it. Mm-hmm. I think the problem that some towns have had is that they've taken so many school choice kids that they've created the need for an additional classroom. Oh,
that's not the case here.
And we only have one class here.
Correct.
Yeah. And we're not
three students or 15 students in it, we're going to have that class.
Correct.
Unless we combine classes, mm-hmm. which I don't want to do.
I don't want to see that either.
So,
yeah.
You don't have to sell me on the idea that
it wasn't so much a sell, but just an explanation. Again, my parameters.
This is nice.
My parameters are what this school committee has given me in terms of target size. And 18 to 20 is our target size. And that's a good number in any elementary school in this area. And I would like to see our 13 climb a little bit higher to 17 or 18. Just because, again, there's also some critical mass that happens in a classroom, too. Kids have personalities.
Would you be able to find out how many of those kids went on to Frontier?
You probably could. I don't know how I would go about it, but I could give it some thought and talk to Darius and see about that. Yeah. In terms of the graduates each year, how many go?
How many school choice leaving sixth grade go on to Frontier?
Yeah, I'm sure we could work that out. They have data. I'm sure we could work it out.
The other thing I'd like to be mindful of, and I agree with Don, that we should get as many school choice as we can to help fill the classrooms to a reasonable size. Mm-hmm. But is the 7, like if we're going to, we need to keep looking ahead and see if that's going to keep going down. We don't want the school to be all school choice.
In terms of the census.
Yeah.
Right? Like that's the problem that I want to pay attention to.
But then what do you do, Katie? What is the solution?
Well, then the town might say, why do we have a school? Right? So I think we have to pay attention to that and kind of look a few years out and really try and anticipate what's going to happen. And we can't control that potentially.
Yeah, low birth rates on any given year.
But we should be watching it.
I can talk to the town clerk because we should be, I think not last year, the year before, Whately only had 2 births.
I know.
So going forward, and if they stay, then in 5 years, we're going to have 2 kids a kindergarten.
You're right. So then, it just begs a lot of questions, and we need to be ready and thinking about that.
Right. And while there's...
I don't want to predict anything right now, but... And but you want to keep contributing to the...
Well, while some residents would ask that question, I think there are many others who, if it was proposed that our kids would go to school elsewhere, I think would probably pitchforks would come out and they would rally
That's
around.
That's true, but there aren't that many of them, so I don't know.
I think they'd have to be careful.
You were forks.
There are a lot of people without children in the town, so I mean, you have to be very mindful of...
That's exactly right.
Again, the value that the school is delivering.
Those are all the reasons why we're in this.
You see the cycles of towns, and you know, you get to the point where for a good 5 to 7 years, you've got all retirees who are retired but still in their own homes. Mm. And then you see that more houses will come on the market when they decide that they're going to downsize. And then you've got more families, and then you'll have another 10 to 18 years of younger families coming in. So you do have to watch those cycles.
Yeah.
But as we all know, the enrollment for the Commonwealth and for our four towns
for our area is
has
going
been
down.
Down, down.
I would
down.
Love Whately to be one of the surviving schools in the area. It should be. Whately is a great school. It should be surviving. But we have to pay attention to that and make it.
Mm-hmm. And there, you know, there was talk the other night about doing, you know, K through six and doing a regionalization of K through 6, and there again, no one's going to give up their schools. So until that happens, but it may come down to it. I mean, if these numbers in 10 years drop another 25, 30, 40%.
Yep.
Well, but that's partly why I gave you the retrospective, too, because the trends are pretty I'm no statistician, but this is pretty stable.
Yeah.
Patty's laughing.
I'm no statistician.
Patty knows me better than that. I'm not a math guy, but these numbers are, you know, if you look at them, they're really quite stable. You know, we've had some peaks. 135 was you know, FY13. We had 135 total student body. And if you look at that, you know, school choice certainly contributed to that. But if you look, we had 49 in FY13. But we also had 49 in FY12, and we only had 121 total. So our Whately population can change quite a bit from grade to grade when you have a small school.
Yeah.
You know, but if you look at the trends, you know, the 124 average at the end of 9 years, there's not that much variation. Again, if you, I'm not a math guy, but if you throw out the high and the low, you start to see that it's pretty stable numbers across the board. If we start to see those numbers continue to drop, and I don't know the census numbers year to year, I didn't do that research, but I'm sure birth rates are probably dropping. You know, the larger census around Massachusetts would indicate that in this area that's
true. Actually, it does spike a little bit going in the other direction, because I did talk to Lynn about that.
Meaning?
And I don't remember what
we picked
class
up some?
Coming up, but there is a big growth in number of kindergarten eligible kids coming in the near future.
Oh, that's good to know,
okay.
too.
Deerfield on the census, you mean?
Yeah,
okay,
from the
so
census.
That's good. So
I know Deerfield is
so.
Glad we are looking overwhelmed
at
it. With them.
In
like
Sunderland.
50 of them in Deerfield.
But Sunderland could be driven by the apartments,
yeah,
too.
It
where,
is driven.
Where that's a
we
little
can look at the birth. We can look at the birth rates in Conway and Whately and predict our kindergartens.
Mm-hmm.
With Deerfield and Sunderland, the birth years mean nothing. We have to look at the censuses.
Mm-hmm.
Or census, what is the plural of
census?
Census?
I don't know.
So yeah, we can look at that.
I've been meaning to ask, there was a long-range planning effort going on.
I am just writing an email to this guy because
he
promised me Friday, today the latest. I've been haunting this man since summer, since Dr. Carey came on. And I told the town of Whately last Wednesday, he promised me Friday, Monday the latest. Mm-hmm. And I'm sitting here before we even said, I'm like, wait a minute, Mark didn't give me my report, so I'm typing right now. You promised me a report by last Friday, latest today. Nothing's been received. Please advise.
Mm-hmm. You can't blame it on the snow.
So that report will look at some of this and
will shed a lot of
shed
light
some light as to what we should be planning for.
I got you on that.
Thank you.
Okay.
So what I can do, now we anticipated this report this year. Usually I come to you in April with this report, so we're doing it a month early, but I can certainly keep you updated next month in terms of, you know, how our advertising turns out in terms of whether we get more school choice applications. And I intend to accept everything that we have at the moment. And it's not, you know, again, the upper grades where I show, you know, third through six, where there's only between one and three slots tops, there's a possibility that we would have to do a lottery if I get, you know, four applicants for grade four or five. But if not, I'm going to accept them as they come in and get our classrooms ready for next year.
I mean, it's amazing because I went from kindergarten down to sixth grade in anticipating classroom sizes, and it's every one of them. Again, there's the upper class, there are one short of the anticipated 20, but it's just amazing that we're not at a number one 20 in classroom, you know, classroom five or, you know, grade five. It's just amazing how it's everyone's less. And down the lower grades, like you were saying, the lower grades would scare all of us probably if that anticipates going through. But there again, you know what's happened in the other school system where we do get the kids from, you know, I won't mention the towns, but there's a couple of them that we get a lot of them from. So
I'm not great with percentages off the top of my head, but with a school that averages, 120 something kids, K through six, not pre-K because we don't do school choice there. And 38, even now, at a low number, 38 of them are school choice. And yes, your point is well taken. Even with that, we still have room. So your point
what
is
do you
well
want
taken.
The percentage? 38 of what?
38 of 121 kids.
31.
That's 31%. So with 30% of our kids being school choice, we still have room for more. That speaks to our population.
And that would be up from where we are right now.
Yeah.
In pre-K, how's it going with pre-K, with being full-time with applications?
We've sent out a lot of that. We've sent out enough applications to fill the classroom. Yeah.
Not everybody has given
a check.
Right,
yet,
but we have enough. We haven't received, we don't consider them enrolled till we receive the deposit, but we have enough enrolled with a couple of waitings if we don't get the checks from the people. So Kim says it's looking fabulous right now. So,
and most of those, I would say probably, would you say 80% of those will go on to school choice? If they're not kids, Whately residents, go to school choice in the kindergarten next year or the year after that, I should say? Or
really
hard, is it hard to say?
Just like this, just like you see on these sheets, it varies from year to year. It's really hard to say. Yeah. But our job is to, yeah, we want them to stay here with us, of course.
That'd be another thing that we can do in the future. Keep once, if this is successful, we can just keep track, okay, after pre-K,
how many stay on with us?
I mean,
because they have made their friends, and the parents are used to the school, and then principal and all that other.
Say, Pete?
Yes, sir.
When they apply, do you have to accept in order of application, or do you look at all the applications?
You can't. First of all, with school choice, there's no choosing. If you have more this is again a great opportunity for me to remind everybody that unlike charter schools, we don't. You know, you get the kids you get, the ones that, and that's true for school choice too. Mm-hmm. If I have eight applicants and I have five openings. There's nothing to review. We put them in a bowl, give them a number, and pull numbers. We cannot discriminate. You know, we can't keep kids out because they've got an IEP or because, you know, whatever.
Don't you look at gender, though? You can't.
No.
No.
You can't.
Nothing.
Balance gender?
Nope. Yep. You put a team together with the players that show up. That's the way it works.
I like that.
So, if you have any questions, I'm
good report.
Happy to answer them for you.
This 9 year thing is.
Yeah, I just.
Would you give me another copy?
I don't have that one. I have it saved. So. Well, if you're happy about the numbers, Patty and I also, we didn't talk about it at the Finance Committee, but over the past 5 years, and this is with the budget that we had the other night, the 2.9 budget, over the past 5 years, our average request to the town. It was 1.9% over the past five years. And a little lower if, now that we've lowered this one, it would be slightly lower than that. Again, I just think that's good perspective, you know. 1.9% most years covers steps, raises, and cost of living. and our programming. We find ways to, you know, we've definitely added some programming, but we find ways to manage that. And I think a reasonable increase in the budgets.
That's a good stat.
Paul, the other thing, I've been on a lot of negotiation teams over the years, and sometimes, I'm not going to just pick on Whately, but sometimes towns, so they have a chance to send a representative also. Since you're retired, maybe next time in negotiation, we're always looking for somebody else that can give us a different perspective of it. And it would be a big, it would help a lot, because sometimes as a school
committee, they would have to appoint him.
But yeah. Wouldn't it be a conflict?
Finance committee.
Oh, yeah.
Because his wife is a teacher in one of the schools?
No.
She must be retiring some days.
Okay. Kindergarten.
Don't tell her. Don't bring that up.
Well, tell her to retire.
Maybe we could just have you as a consultant.
But your point is, we could get someone else.
Anybody.
Like if you have
anybody, but the problem that's happened before, Paul, like I said about meetings, no one ever comes, so it's like, I go, you know, because I've been on both Frontier and Uke School Union 38 for many times in many years.
Right.
And somebody, you know, I can see a person from Deerfield, maybe from Conway, but Whately's not there.
Yeah.
And there again, it's only three select boards, so it has to be either a select board or the town administrator, I think. But you could also.
I think this came up before, and because of Maureen's position over in Deerfield, we couldn't move, ahead with it. So,
final point here, Pete?
That's it. I just wanted you to know where we stand with where we have, what we have for applications now. We've advertised. Oh, by the way, in each of our advertisements, we also included that we are taking applications for pre-K, too. The ones in the paper as well as the ones with the Hilltown Family
it.
Network.
We doubled down on our advertising. And that's good value.
But we have money in that line item.
So as the next couple of months go by and we see where the applications are coming and in which grades, we can make some decisions about how many I'll accept, from grade to grade. You know, if the numbers stay low, I'll accept everybody. If the numbers get bigger, I might have to hold the lottery in certain grades. But that will always be in conjunction with us talking about it here, so that you know what I'm about to do.
Good. You have more for your report?
That's it.
Okay. Chair's report, the only thing that I'm reporting is that my intention is not to seek re-election, so I'm announcing to the town and all those people watching that the position will be open, and maybe Mr. Ante would be interested in it. I've served my time.
I would like to support Bob's point of getting more people involved, and if it's helpful to talk to any of us about what's involved or what is entailed, we'd be happy to speak to people.
I mean, I got off school
encourage committee. Encourage them to participate. Yeah,
I got off school committee a few years ago to give a younger parent a choice to be elected and come aboard and do something, and that didn't work out. And I was happy to come. I was happy. I have nothing else on my mind. I mean, I like coming and doing it, but someday if another parent really wants to run, I'm not going to hold back and take that away from another parent that could be wants me on the school committee. So,
well, Don, I'm going to be sad to see you go, but I know you've spent your life as a dedicated educator and most of your retirement being on the school committee. So I will miss you, but I understand your decision.
Right. We'll find another person.
We'll have a party for you.
I can go to the party.
No conflict there.
All right, with that said, superintendent's report.
In light of the time,
yeah.
And that I spoke plenty tonight, fortunately, I really didn't have anything planned. My blog this month, my message this month, really was the one that was put in here, and I was thrilled to have a chance to elaborate on it. So thank you very much.
Okay, good. Anything else?
Make a motion to adjourn, sir.
We have a motion to adjourn.
Second.
Any further discussion? All in favor?
Aye.
All right, we're adjourned.
Thank you.